Morning.
Morning.
Someone left a bottle up here, somebody left one each. Might recognize the bottle, missing the bottle. It is. Mr. Dale. Continuing our lesson in the book of James. So my typical ritual for preparing for the lesson is reading it, looking at it throughout the week, but then on Sunday mornings when I sit down and put everything, put pen on paper, and all my thoughts down and kind of organize it. So this morning, overslept a little bit. So I woke up 2 hours later than I planned on waking up. Got the coffee pot that I scheduled to come on, it goes off automatically 2 hours later, the coffee pot was already off. So I had a lot less time this morning to put it on paper. Luckily, I kind of knew what the lesson was on and didn't know what I was doing. I just was rushed to put it down on paper. We're going to start in James chapter 4, starting in verse 1. What causes fights and quarrels among you? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you? So who is James writing to here? He's talking about fights and quarrels. If you look at the passage of scripture in the book, the translation it uses talks about wars and fights or wars and battles. Who's James talking to? It sounds like he's talking to a group of people that are angry and heathens. Who's he writing the book to? Church. Right. The church. So fights and quarrels. The Christians fight and quarrel. Do we have desires for things that we do not or cannot have? So we read back in James, I think it was James chapter 1. He also talked about sin comes from the desires within us, and once those desires give birth to sin, or action gives birth to sin. So as Christians, he's talking to us, and he starts off this chapter, this part of this book, the very strong section of the lesson, the book of the lesson, he talks about that. The verbiage in this chapter is a lot stronger. The words he uses are a lot stronger than it is in the previous chapters. So verse 2. You want something, but do not get it. You kill and covet, but you cannot have what you want. You quarrel and fight. You do not have because you do not ask God. So if you look in the book, it talks about James's. During James's time, there were a lot of poor people. And so this was partially directed at poor people who were always looking to get handouts from people who had money. But I think the lesson can definitely be applied to more than that. If you look at the church today, do we see these kind of actions going on? Hopefully we don't see murder, we don't see people killing each other. But have you ever seen a Christian throw another Christian under the bus because of the selfish desire that they have? It happens, right? It doesn't necessarily happen in the church building, but it does happen within the church. We see it way too often. I see it a lot at work, people with their careers. So Christian men and women who are very open about being Christian at work. Sometimes we can bring the Bible to work and all that. But an opportunity comes to throw somebody else under the bus because it's going to make them look better. Too many people take that opportunity. I've actually been very surprised at that in the last year or two from what I've seen at work. So it's not uncommon to think that the church today, which is made up of believers from across the whole world, it's not just our local congregation. In church today, the problems that James was talking about 2,000 years ago, we're having the same problems today. What about in our homes? I think we see the same thing in our homes. Do we see that selfish desire put forth where we do something to our spouse selfishly, not thinking about our spouse but ourselves? Married couples disagree, I think, to the point of an argument, and then it may be about money. One person wants to go buy something, the other thing's not a good idea. So you disagree, you have these arguments, these quarrels. So that's what James is talking about. He's saying, church, you're still arguing, you're still fighting, you're still disagreeing over things, and you're not doing it the right way. And the last part of that verse, what is the last part of that verse say? Verse 2. Why do we do not have?
Because
we don't ask God. So no matter what it is, whatever we're arguing about, typically, we haven't gone to God. We're not asking God for what we think is the best. guidance in our life. A verse that parallels to this is in Matthew chapter 7. It's interesting to see how often James repeats and kind of adds additional or puts a different spin on the words of Jesus. In Matthew chapter 7, starting in verse 7. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. He who seeks finds. And to him who knocks, the door will be opened. Which of you, if his son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, you give him a snake? If you then, you who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him? So in everything, do to others what you would have them do to you. For this sums up the law and the prophets. So this section, I think a lot of people look at, and it almost looks as if Jesus is saying here, God is this genie in the bottle. He's just asking for something, he's going to give it to you, right? That's an easy way to take this if you don't really dig in and try to figure out what it's talking about. So what is he saying when he says, ask and you will receive? Where's the caveat to that? We don't really see that right there. And he says, ask and you will receive, seek and you will find. What's he saying? You're going to get everything you ask for. Now, I think we know better than that, right? If you look at verse 12, it ends that passage. It almost looks out of place. Why do you think verse 12 is there? Everything due to others is what I've been due to you. He's talking about ask, seek, knock. He's talking about that. Why does he end it saying due to others as you would have to do to you? I was perplexed by it as well. So I got to thinking about it. And if you look at some of the other scriptures where Jesus is talking, he's talking on subjects. He'll kind of give you something about what the problem is or what you need to do. And then he'll give you the why or the how. And so to me, I think what Jesus is saying here, if you're asking for things, God will give you the things that you're asking for. It may not be exactly the way you're asking for it. But to do that, you've got to be treating others as you would have them treat you. If you're out there in the world treating others, throwing people under the bus, and when you go ask God for something, he's going to treat you. That's my interpretation. I would love to hear your thoughts on that. That's my thoughts of why that's there. That's the, if you'll do this, then you will receive.
I would say the other thing he says there, when he says, ask, seek, and receive, Jesus is talking, he also immediately jumps into and says, what is your Father going to give you? Good things. So that doesn't mean he's going to give you what you want. He says he's going to give you good things, things that you need. Look at James. James makes it real clear. James says, when he talks about it, he said, make it real clear, huh? A little blank. Promotes that you may spend on what you get on your pleasures. In other words, it's, most people ask for things like it's Santa Claus, expecting that's what I'm going to get. And that's not what he's talking about in either case. Jesus is not saying it. James is not saying it. Sure, just ask. What he's saying is, you talk to God about things that are not about selfish things of yourself. And you're doing, God knows what's good things to do, and God gives those. Too many times, I think we've got this, well, there is a belief out there that if you do the right things, you do the right things, you ask God, God's going to give you all these blessings that are material blessings. So if I want a new car, you're going to get a new car, you know. And promote that on TV. That's not what it says, in my
opinion. Okay. John, the difference.
That was a short knowledge. That was a short knowledge. Does that mean that we're not supposed to ask for things that we want and we don't need? Do we not ask when we talk to God? Or our wants and desires?
Well, do you ask your dad for things that you want? Or yeah. Did you when you were younger?
Yeah.
I think we ask. But don't be surprised and don't be mad if you don't get the new car. Which is, I think, the point that really he's trying to say is, yeah, we need to talk to him. Like he says, your Father in heaven knows what you need.
That was my point.
And I think, you know,
when we talk to him, I think we can ask him for it.
I don't disagree with that. I just think we need to be careful because, like James was saying, it's about your own personal pleasure.
Right.
Too many times, that's the top of our list. What makes me happy?
Most of them.
Yeah. And I don't think that's really where he's going. And tag you on what she just said. What scripture just preceded James?
Exactly.
Which wisdom are we supposed to use? Godly or worldly?
Stop praying for healing and we start praying for the suffering to end. So I think that is a perfect example.
Corey, I had this written down in my Bible, and I probably didn't come up with this. I don't know if I did or not. But anyway, it says in my margin, I thank God for protecting me from what I thought I wanted and blessing me with what I didn't know I needed.
So if you're selfishly asking God for something, you're not going to get it. That's what he's saying. That's what verse 3 says. If you're selfishly asking, you're not going to get it. You ask with the wrong motives. So I read this and went back to one of my favorite examples, my kids. It's human nature to do that. It's human nature to ask for things with the wrong motives. So as early as 1, Evan learned to ask for things. So he would come up to you and he wants gum. So gum. And so you give him a piece of gum and you start to go give him one and he says, doo. And I'm like, no, you don't need 2 pieces of gum. He says, Brooke. Like he's going to take one to Brooke. So half the time he does actually take it to Brooke, but half the time he wants to say a piece for himself. He comes to church and goes through a whole pack of Nana's gum every Sunday. So I think it's human nature. It's something we do learn in the early age. We do learn how to be selfish. We learn how to get around and get things we want by asking in a different way. So we may not come to God and say, hey, I want this brand new truck. We may come to God and say, man, my car, I've been having all this truck, these issues with it. I've had it at the shop so many times. God, what am I going to do? You know, you're hoping that he's going to give you this brand new truck. But you've got the wrong motives. You're going to God selfishly because you want this brand new thing. I think we see it in our marriages as well. So husbands, how often do you pray for your wife? Is that a daily thing that you do, is you pray for your wife? You pray for what's best for your wife? How often do you pray for what's best for your children? Again, husbands. Fathers, how often do you pray for your children? Not just when they're sick, not just when something big's going on, but how often do you pray for them day to day, throughout the day? Are you praying to God, for God to give them the things that are best for them? Or do you spend more time praying on things that you're concerned with and things that affect you? So let me turn that around. Wives, how often do you pray for your husbands? Are you praying for your husband every day? Are you praying for things that your husband needs? Or are you spending more time on what you want, what you need? It's a little bit different for mothers, I think, than it is for fathers. I know mothers pray 1,000 times a day for their children. But ladies, how often are you praying for your husband, not just your children? Are we seeking God with selfish motives, or do we come before Him seeking what's best for others, or even what's best for the kingdom? I think a lot of times we need to focus our prayers, to your case, on what's best for the kingdom, right? What's best for God's people and His cause. So moving on to verse 4. You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world is hatred toward God? Anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. So we've seen other passages before, I think, in the Bible that talk about being an enemy of God. And I think in other passages, we kind of look at it and we think we understand it. We think, yeah, we understand. We don't need to be worldly and all that. But James looked at it differently. James puts it to us differently than other passages. He uses the word adulterous. So what does it mean, adulterous? What's he talking about? What is adultery? Unfaithfulness to your spouse, right? Being unfaithful to your spouse. So he's using an analogy here. He's using this word. Why is he using that word? Hannah says, Perky says it's not. The church is the bride of Christ. So James uses that word. It's a strong word. It gets our attention. It's something that you look at. It gets your attention. But a lot of times as you're reading through the Bible, if you're just reading kind of your daily Bible, a lot of times you'll kind of skip over it because you think of adultery and physical marital sin. But when you look at it as this analogy, so we'll pick on John. So John was the first one to do it. So imagine John, who's married to Jody, having some inappropriate relationship with his other. And John's view is, well, I'm married, I've given her my whole life. You know, I live with her, I'm with her most of the time. What's the big deal if I'm with this other woman occasionally? You know, why does that matter? I think that's the kind of the example that he's talking about here is you claim to be a Christian, profess to be a Christian, but then you go off and do these things in the world and just act like it's not a big deal. You act like it's not adultery. It's not the opposite of being a Christian. I think that's the process that, or at least that's in my mind, that's the process that it gets in my head when we're examining our relationship with God. To compare it to your relationship with someone that we love here on earth.
And Corey is, I think, a gospel preacher, I'm going to say it one time, that in a relationship like that, either with your spouse or with your church, faith and perfection are not the same thing. You know, you're not going to be perfect in either one of them. But remaining dedicated, you know, married to them with love and dedication, that's what it is, and it's not perfection.
That's why you pray, not asking for yourself, but you have to pray for your spouse, that the Lord will go ahead and take her.
You realize she's praying the same thing to you.
I have no comment about that.
We're trying to give it.
So verse 5. Or do you think Scripture says that without reason, that the Spirit calls, that He calls to live in us, envies intensely. Let me read that again because I just butchered it. Or do you think Scripture says without reason, that the Spirit He calls to live within us, envies intensely, or is jealous? And so he's saying here, just like your husband or your wife is jealous, as they should be, of any relationship that your spouse has with the opposite sex, God is the same way with the relationship that we have with the world. We see that throughout the Bible. God is a jealous God. When you look at it, when you look at your relationship with God, just like the relationship with a spouse, it's a whole lot easier to understand that concept, to understand why God gets angry when we go live in sin.
It's not always, I mean, it doesn't have to be adultery with another person. You can do the same thing with a job, some hobby you had where it's taken away your time, that you should be with your spouse, and your spouse can become jealous of that, and that is adultery. And you can do the same thing with God. You come to church, you do all the things that you think you need to do, but like before I came here, friend of mine who professed to be a Christian. I got a new truck and he had a new boat, so we got together and started going fishing. And it started out, we go to church on Sunday and then go fishing, and then it ended up all fishing and no church. And that's the same thing. You're cheating God with your pleasures instead of the boat we were supposed to get done and what we were doing before we were facing.
Very good. I like that. So verse 6, he goes on and he says, but he, God, gives us more grace. That is why Scripture says God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. So again, continue that analogy of the marriage. God opposes the proud, those that are out for themselves. Those who are selfish, who want praise for all the things that they've done. Just like the marriage analogy I talked about, and using John as an example, the husband's proud because he spent his whole life with his wife. He didn't get divorced. You know, he's got this woman that he's still scripturally married to, but yet there's this inappropriate relationship going on in the world. And it's the same thing with God. God shows favor to those who are humble, to those who come before Him, praying for the needs of others, praying for His will to be done and not your will to be done. Verse 7 through 9. Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Come near to God and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. So again, continuing on that marriage analogy, I think James starts down that path, and that's kind of the analogy I want to use as we talk through this. James knows what he's doing. He's getting in mind to think of that. So he's comparing your relationship with God to your relationship with a spouse. So submit to God. Submit to God just as you submit to your husband or wife. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. So in your marriage, you resist temptation with anybody of the opposite sex who's not your spouse. You don't even want to start down that road that could become an inappropriate relationship. And that's something that I've seen, again, at work way too often. People start out innocently this relationship with somebody of opposite sex that ends up turning into more than it should be. It's one of those things that because I've seen it in others, personally, I try to protect myself from that. And I have a policy, I will not go to lunch with somebody of the opposite sex. Doesn't matter what it is, even work-related, whatever. I just will not do that with just me and her. You don't even want to have that relationship that could look bad toward others, give the wrong impression toward others, or get your mind going down the wrong road. So in the same way, don't even entertain the idea of something that is in opposition to God, something that will interfere with your relationship with Him. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Come near to God and he will come near to you. So again, back to that relationship. When you're in a relationship with a husband, a wife, a son, a father, whatever it is, I'll use Lindsay and I as an example. When do we have the most trouble? When do we struggle the most in our marriage? It's when we don't talk. When we sit down, we don't we'll watch TV or play with the kids, but we don't really talk to each other. Even when we're not talking intentionally, we're not talking to not talk. But the longer we go without talking, the more one of us is going to get frustrated and make the other one mad or whatever. So I think it's the same thing with God. Come near God. Stay close to God and He will come near to you. But God is not just going to stay there in your life when you're not reciprocating that. You're sitting there. Actually, I'll use an example. There's a video my brother sent me. He's a comedian. And one of the parts that it talked about, on average, women have 20,000 words a day and men only have 12,000. That's why men get home from work every day and they sit there in front of the TV and they don't talk. And they've already used 10,000 words today. They only have 2,000 left. But the man gets home and the wife's only used 8,000. She's got 12,000 left to go, so she's talking away. While you're sitting there just trying to watch TV.
Hey, Corey. Kim may have 20,000, but I'm pretty sure I only hear a couple of hundred a day, man.
So again, in that relationship, if you're not, the relationship is one-sided. If God is trying to talk to you and all you're doing is sitting there and you only hear 200 words a day, God's not going to continue to try to use 20,000 words or whatever. So the same example, draw near to God, he'll draw near to you. It takes both ways. You have to also ask God for the things that you need and ask God for the things that others need. And the longer you're away from somebody, the longer it takes to catch up. It's the same with God. The longer you're away from God, the longer it takes to remember what that relationship is like when you're close to Him again. What about verse 9? Verse 9, grieve, mourn, and wail, change laughter in the morning, joy to gloom. I want to hear your thoughts on that. It's an interesting verse, isn't it? But to me, it's one of those verses. I think I've talked a little bit before in lessons that God doesn't necessarily want you just because you're a Christian, just because you're a follower of Him. Doesn't mean your whole life's going to be happy. It's not what God promised us as His children, was our whole life's going to be happy. So grieve, mourn, and wail. So rather than living out in the world and when problems are going on and your relationship with God isn't going right, don't just continue to get out there and be this joyous, happy person and laugh and do all these things that you shouldn't be doing. When it's appropriate, grieve. When it's appropriate, mourn. Don't laugh over everything when it's time to mourn. That's kind of my thoughts on that. Anybody have another take?
Well, I see it as contrasting the world versus God, and it's like, repent. Those are all the characteristics of repentance, God expects for repentance. And basically saying, repent instead of having a good time and being happy and fun in the world, repent, come back to God, submit to Him, repent rather than living in the world and being having fun.
Well, if we look at the things going on in the world,
leading up to it, it's talking about selfishness, it's talking about wanting God for you and you only. So look at the things going on around you, grieve for those who need grieve more for the things that are going on that should not be. The last verse in the lesson, in verse 10. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and He will lift you up. That's a song that we sing, one of my favorite songs. When you're proud, when you have pride, you're a proud person, kind of put yourself on a pedestal. You lift yourself up for others to see what you've done, what you've accomplished, whatever. In verse 6, before this, said, God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. So in verse 10, He says, humble yourselves, and He will lift you up. He's saying that in contrast to pride. If you're prideful, you're already lifted up. You're self-lifted up. You're making yourself there for the world to see. But if you humble yourselves, God will lift you up. And that may not mean here on this earth. He may not lift you up in this earthly world, but He will lift you up. So I think, to me, that's something, what do you think would be more fulfilling, lifting yourself up or God lifting you up? I think we can easily answer that and say it would be a whole lot better to have God lift you up and lift yourself up. So submit to God, be a servant of others and to Him, and He will lift you up. Anybody have any other thoughts before we close?
I would think that if you do not know how to humble yourself, I would say that if you don't know how to humble yourself, you would be fortunate if God did bring things into your life that you could then become humble. Because that's the way you become nearer to God. As long as you are not in need, you may think, or day by day, you may not even think of God. But when you're afflicted, the things happen in verse 9, you're afflicted or you're sorrowful or you weep, you'll turn to God. So that's one way that we can stay near to God.
Good point. Another verse, pride comes before a fall. You cannot become humble. You're prideful, so you must have a fall. I think that's kind of what you're saying, right? Anybody else? Let's go to a little prayer. Heavenly Father God, we come to you this morning thanking you once again for the opportunity to come together as a congregation, as a body of believers, Lord, to look at your word and to learn more from your word about how we should live in our lives. God, we pray that we're able to, in our lives here, we're able to look to you, God, and we're able to make our relationship with you such that we're not out there doing anything in the world, such that other people can see us, God. See that we are Christians so that it then points them to you. Lord, we thank you for Christians that we sit here with, that we can learn from one another. We pray that as we go to worship God, that you will clear our minds, help us to look to you, and to praise you and worship you.